Welcome to Your Intuition. You know what I'm going to talk about if you have subscribed to this channel. If you haven't, please do so because this might be good for your mental well-being in the current climate and weather. I'm not a registered psychologist. Therefore, please just consider my talks as fairy tales. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. Nowadays, the mass media have been focusing on how many degrees the surface temperature might increase in the next century or so with the increasing greenhouse gases. That could make you psychologically depressed. But do you know the tremendous global warming such greenhouse gases had made, together with water vapor, of course? Not 1.5 degree, not 3 degree, but 33 degree Celsius or 33 Kelvin. This is called the greenhouse effect type 1. In fact, the greenhouse gases are great heroes for making such a tremendous global warming. You can easily Google the related reference. In this diagram, for example, the relative proportion of water vapor, clouds, CO2 are 50%, 25%, 19% or 20% respectively. If one assumes the 100% correspond to the total warming, 33 Kelvin, then one could argue that the percent CO2 with concentration 400 ppm in the atmosphere has reached the global mean surface temperature by 5 degrees already. Water vapor about 16 Kelvin and clouds about 8 Kelvin. The heat is balanced. What do you think? It seems clouds can also warm up the Earth as the greenhouse gases do by blocking the upward surface radiation and emit downward to the surface. After all, clouds are made by water drops and ice particles whose infrared absorption spectra are similar to water vapor. According to climate experts such as Ramanathan, however, clouds can effectively reflect the shortwave radiation from the sun. As he wrote, clouds are almost always more reflective than the ocean surface and land, except where there is a snow. In effect, clouds can significantly reduce the solar radiation intensity at the surface. Such functions of clouds stand apart from CO2 and other trace element greenhouse gases. Before I go further, let's add some background. In 1997, Kills and Trendbirth proposed an equation based on their understanding of greenhouse effect hypothesis and some instrumental observation of outgoing non-wave radiation, or ORR. This is the equation. G for greenhouse gases is equal to the difference between the surface radiation minus the ORR. The surface radiation is about 390 watt per meter square if the surface can be treated as a black body at 288 Kelvin in vacuum. ORR is close to 239 watt per meter square. In this case, the total greenhouse effect is about 150 watt per meter square, the absolute value. At the first glance, this equation looks marvelous, because it is consistent with the vivid notion that the greenhouse gases can block the upward non-wave radiation and emit backward to the surface. Nevertheless, this equation is based on a hypothesis, namely, ORR must be originated from the surface infrared radiation, as high as I said, 390 watt per meter square, which could happen only in the absence of the gaseous atmosphere. In the standard greenhouse effect model, the net upward long-wave radiation from the surface is about 50 watt meter square. Well, as you might have known, the surface infrared radiation is actually close to zero. In both cases, the greenhouse effect or the radiative forcing of the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere should be always negative. Does this mean the greenhouse effect type 1 is actually cooling? Now, you know the equation proposed by Kills and Trendbus for quantifying the greenhouse effect in terms of radiative forcing is not unconditionally meaningful. That's why the IPCC had to introduce the second definition for the radiative forcing based on a preset imbalance at the top of the atmosphere as kind of a priori. Did you notice that? Instead of measuring by instrument the real ORR, climate researchers prefer to calculate the upward long-wave radiation at different CO2 concentrations based on the greenhouse effect hypothesis. Their results show the imbalance due to CO2 doubling is between 3 and 4 watt per meter square. It has been assumed that such an imbalance is permanent and irreversible. In fact, the argument seems so irresistible that had convinced Murray Gell-Mann, the physicist who introduced quarks, before he passed away.
But the thing that I was talking about is not the whole issue.
Yeah.
Just this trivial point about the sum of the
cool, warm,
the sum of the three terms. The random fluctuations, the cyclical behavior,
right?
Because the deniers talk about cycles, and they're right. There are cycles,
yeah, sure.
And there are random terms,
right?
And there is also the secular term,
right?
And I don't understand why people who are supposed to educate the public cannot get this across.
To illustrate their calculated ORR results, this spectra has been often used. As you can see, an upside down dip is centered at 15 micron in wavelength or 667 per centimeter in wave number. It is called the CO2 absorption, which appears as the CO2 concentration increases from 0 ppm. Did you know this was preset instead of observed? This is because an infrared detector, such as the IRIS on the Nimbus satellite, could only record emission signal, which can only be strong or weak, but certainly not negative. How could this happen in the first place? I will report this new discovery very soon, so please stay tuned. Return to our discussion. In 1967, Manabe and Weatherald suggested that clouds have a large late cooling effect on the planet based on their climate modeling. But their remarks were barely discussed apart from their predictions for the stratospherical cooling and tropospherical warming due to CO2 doubling. In 1989, Ramanathan and co-workers suggested the clouds be treated as kind of the greenhouse constituent. In doing so, he defined both long-wave and short-wave forcing for clouds without invoking the surface long-wave radiation. This is very interesting because Ramanathan's forcing is independent of the surface infrared radiation value, unlike the greenhouse gases. To be specific, he estimated that the shortwave cloud forcing is negative 48 watt per meter square because it reflects the solar radiation. And the longwave cloud forcing is 30 watt per meter square. That's the net cloud radiative forcing is negative 18 watt per meter square, which implies clouds always cool this planet. Indeed, the negative 18 watt per meter square cloud forcing can easily offset or kill any positive radioactive forcing caused by CO2 and other trace elements, as shown in this diagram. Of course, such greenhouse effect has been just a hypothesis anyhow. This seems a bit too disappointing for him. As he wrote here, Earth would probably be substantially warmer without clouds. Why? Because Ramanathan had made his fame and fortune by being
there. It's just my personal view, the Gordian knot of the whole climate change problem. In the sense that if the warmer planet becomes less cloudy, the warming can accelerate so large, none of us can cope with that. On the other hand, nature could be merciful. And as the planet warms, maybe there's more water vapor, could produce more clouds, and sort of keep this in check. Of course, it will allow us to abuse the system even more. So we don't know whether the warmer planet is going to be more cloudy or less cloudy.
Strange. He seemed reluctant to accept such a natural response, that more clouds could be generated by the warming. Besides, he failed to understand the Earth who does so is not for the sake of humans or being merciful for us, but for its own survival in the universe. I hope Ramanathan could watch this talk. Still, I was a little bit surprised to notice that he admitted in this chapter, we do not know how the innate forcing of the negative 18 watt per meter square will change in response to global warming. Well, the takeaway messages are, one, the greenhouse effect type 1 cannot be justified when the surface infrared radiation is less than the OLR observed at the top of the atmosphere. And two, the greenhouse effect type 2, namely the hypothetical global warming due to CO2 doubling, can easily be killed by clouds, according to the climate expert Ramanathan. Thank you for viewing. Thank you for donation. See you next time.